And then insulin is a big one too, right? I mean, look at people with diabetes. I don't have the paper right in front of me, but the life expectancy is certainly less than someone without diabetes. And so insulin is a big problem. I'm going to look at it right now and give you a number.
Insulin plays a major role because if we have insulin resistance where we're making more insulin to get our cells to open up to bring glucose and fuel to the cell, that can cause problems because our insulin resistance causes our body to need more insulin to knock on that door. Instead of knocking on the door once, we have to knock on it 2, 3, 4 times. And insulin does a couple of things. It can increase blood pressure. That makes our hearts having to beat at a higher rate, has to harder and stronger to get blood pumping. So more stress on the heart. It's going to decrease blood flow. And so to areas in the feet, to the genitals, to the extremities, to the brain, you may have decrease in blood flow, which may cause an impairment of getting nutrition and oxygenation there. Obviously, it can create oxidative stress on all of our little proteins, all of our little vasculature in the body, because the more you sugarcoat proteins in the body, whether it's our eye vessels, whether it's fingers, toes, that creates oxidative stress because of glycation, right? So think of the creme brulee at the steakhouse. They take the blowtorch over it, right? And it starts to brown on top. That's glycation, right? That sugar coating is oxidizing from that flame. That happens in our body. And that can decrease blood flow. It decreases fluidity and flexibility. There's more inflammation. You start to have problems with the eyes, libido, being able to perform well because you don't have good oxygenation. And then of course, you're depleting a lot of your antioxidant reserves because now there's so much oxidative stress from this glycation that's happening, right? Your body has to use a lot of antioxidants from the food to stabilize all these cells because of all the free radical stress that's happening.
Yeah, it depends on which paper. There were like 3 different ones I was looking at. One was talking about 5-year reduction in life expectancy with diabetes. Another was talking 8 years. Another was talking 10. So I guess it depends. And of course, type 1 and type 2 are different. But in general, I mean, we know that this is it's a comorbidity with a lot of issues we're seeing now too. So this is not, if you can avoid it, obviously type 1, some would argue, is out of your control, but type 2, you certainly have control over that and you can prevent that and reverse it.
Yeah, type 1 is still in your control. I mean, I guess the part of that that's the hardest is most people that are affected by that are kids.
Yeah.
And usually between 5 and 15, there's an autoimmune condition that sets in and starts to destroy the beta cells of the pancreas. And there's a strong correlation with dairy and grains and refined sugar. So every parent out there listening, especially if you have autoimmune in your family history, you really got to have your kids be healthy out of the gates. And so that's, you know, important out of the gates. Also cognitive wise, right? People are worried about Alzheimer's and dementia. There's a strong mechanism with dementia in the plaque in the brain being driven by insulin resistance. They're calling, and it's been called for over a decade, Alzheimer's is going to essentially refer to as type 3 diabetes. So your brain becomes resistant to the glucose as a fuel source in the brain. And there's a lot of plaquing that forms in the brain due to the fact that insulin, the insulin degrading enzyme that helps clean up plaque in the brain, it can clean up plaque or it can go and soak up insulin. And when you're over secreting insulin, that enzyme is more prone and focused on cleaning up insulin and less prone to work on the plaque. So that plaquing and inflammation can go up because that enzyme is too focused over here cleaning up the insulin. So the goal is that we use diet and lifestyle strategies and exercise strategies to lower the insulin. And then that insulin degrading enzyme has more allocation to go after and clean up the plaque in the brain. And then of course, we know if we're burning more fat for fuel, that those ketones, one, they're not going to require insulin. And two, our brain and our neurological system can use ketones for a fuel source as well. So then we're not only relying on one fuel source for the brain, we're also relying on ketones. A lot of data on that out of Harvard by this doctor named Dr. Veach, looking at ketones and fuel for the brain. So that's a really important thing. If you're into and focused on Alzheimer's and dementia prevention, you have to be hyper-focused on utilizing ketones for fuel. You have to be hyper-focused on keeping insulin low because it's very hard to, one, utilize insulin for fuel. Sorry, very hard to utilize ketones for fuel if your insulin levels are high. High levels of insulin prevent your body from burning fat. Ketones, a fat byproduct, right? Free fatty acid, glycerol, ketone metabolites. You break that down. You need nice low insulin levels to break that down, and then you can start burning it.
What about people like eating a donut and then they go take exogenous ketones?
That may be palliative from a like cognitive kind of like boost standpoint. Like I'm going to study for something for an hour or two or read this book and really be into it. but that's not fixing the underlying issue. You need to shift your hormones so you can be in a overall fat burning state. So you need to increase things like hormone sensitive lipase, and you need to decrease insulin. Those are on opposite seesaws. So to get hormone sensitive lipase, these are fat digesting, fat breaking down enzymes. To increase those, you have to drop insulin low to do that. Yeah, and again, when you drop insulin low, it's not just about restricting carbohydrates. This is like kind of where the, you know, the carbohydrate thesis kind of goes out the window, is you can still increase insulin and blood sugar by eating inflammatory foods. So if you're getting exposed to mold, for instance, that could still increase cortisol and get your blood sugar higher without actually consuming glucose or carbohydrate rich food. So you could have mold coming in, you could have heavy metals coming in, you could just be eating like soy protein or artificial sweeteners that may not necessarily impact your blood sugar directly, but they could be having a hormonal influence, pushing that blood sugar out of balance. Of course, the hormones in the food, right? The pesticides in food, all these things can play a role. So it's not just the macros, it's the macros, but also the quality of those macros. And again, you know, keep it simple, right? Old foods don't cause new disease. If you're consuming grass-fed butter and you have a serious dairy issue, that could be a problem too. So you got to look at the whole picture, food quality, micro and macronutrients, and the toxins that could be in those food, and the food allergy component.
Yeah, well said.